Star Trek books. They've been around for decades. Join us, the Trek ladies, Kavora and Jen, as we discuss the novels one at a time. Welcome to the Ladies Trek Library.
Hello, and we're back with Ladies Trek Library. I'm Kavora, and I'm here with Jen. Hi, Jen.
Hey, Kavora. Really nice to be back.
Great. And so our book this time is The 3-Minute Universe by Barbara Paul. And I'll just read the description on the back of the book. The Sackers. In all Captain James T. Kirk's travels, he has never found a race more universally shunned and abhorred. Their mere appearance causes most Federation members to become violently ill. Now the Sackers have performed a deed whose brutality matches their horrifying exterior. They have stolen a revolutionary new scientific device, murdering an entire race in the process, and used it to create a rip in the fabric of space, a hole through which another universe is rapidly leaking. Unless Captain Kirk and the crew of the Enterprise can find a way to stop the new universe's expansion, it will consume and utterly destroy our own. So that's it. And so it does sound like a pretty big story, one of those destroy the universe kind of things. But it was actually about meeting a new race and getting to know them and understanding them is kind of the way I see it. So it does enter this new race that they, at first, they're called the Sackers because that's just what the humans named them. What did you think of the Sackers, Jen?
Well, it reminded me a bit of the Medusans from Is There in Truth No Beauty, the original series episode. Remember the Medusans who, no one could look upon because they would be blinded.
Yes.
So in that sense, it was sort of similar because, no one could, if you looked at them, you became violently ill. Their smell made you ill. Listening to them made you go deaf. And what was the other thing? Oh,
their touch.
Yeah, their touch burned you. So it was a little bit on the Medusans, which I thought that was somewhat interesting.
So the fact that they're just, the way the book describes it, they offend all five of the human senses. So it's like, how can anybody stand to be with them? That's why no one had ever negotiated with them. And it was hard to even get started because, well, and of course, they also speak a different language. I did like the story, the way it became, the way everyone got more used to them. Once they started working with them, Kirk, Uhura, Chekhov, and Scotty are working with them, and they do have to, they're wearing helmets, right? The humans are wearing helmets at first, and the Sackers are also wearing a cloak. They're wearing something over them and a hood so that you can't actually see them. And they're wearing their own translators, too, so that the humans can understand what they're saying. And once Kirk and everybody starts working with them, they kind of see, like, oh, these people aren't really as bad as we thought.
Yeah. So especially what I liked was Scotty begins working with one of the Sackers, and the one interesting fact about them is that they don't tell you what their names are, or they don't have names until you call them something, and then they become very happy when they're granted a name. And so they all have kind of like, even though they're supposedly hideous to look at, they all sort of have different colors. And so Scotty is working with an engineer who apparently is green, so he names him Mr. Green. And it's kind of like a cute little friendship between Scotty and Mr. Green, and you see where he really comes to like him and respect him.
Yeah, that was funny. The book was funny in some ways, too. It had some humor, which I liked. And the name Mr. Green reminded me of, the board game Clue.
Yes.
Mr. Green, right? And even there were a few of the Sackers were named after colors like Rose and Brownie. And those were just cute names. And the And so we have Commander Babe, who was named unintentionally because Uhura just said something like, "You better believe it, Babe." And then the one, the sucker that's in command said, "Oh, are you naming me Babe?" And that's the way some of them got named.
Yeah, the names were one of the funny parts of it, because aside from the colors, like you mentioned, and I think there was like a pinky. And then my personal favorite was there was an orange one that Chekhov named Orange Juice and Vodka. But then there was a few other ones that were a little weird. Like there was the Mr. Ma'am, because I guess she heard somebody say Mr. Ma'am and thought that was her name. And then another personal favorite was the one who was the doctor. Chekhov named her Bonesovna, which means daughter of bones, as like a little tribute to Bones. So that was cute. But yeah, the names were funny that they came up with.
Yeah, and the book could almost have been like a young adult novel in some ways. It was very, it did have the serious parts, but it was also very cute. But that was good. I mean, I'm saying those are some of the good things about the book. So what did you think about how the main characters were in the book?
Do you mean the characters, the crew of the Enterprise, or the Sackers?
Yeah, well, all of them. We'll go with who do you think is like worth mentioning first?
Well, so the main Enterprise characters are really Kirk, Uhura, Chekhov, and Scotty, because they are the ones that end up on the Sacker ship. So they are the most, you know, in the book more than any of the crew. And Spock a little bit. He's back on the Enterprise. We don't really see Sulu too much in this one, and Bones a little bit. But I liked it. I always like, especially when Uhura gets more time in books. And so, you know, she was in it a fair bit as all of the Enterprise crew were on the Sacker ship to... Apparently, all of the bridge crew had been killed in an accident, so they said, and they needed training on running the ship. And so Uhura had some Sackers that she was training, and she had little names that she had given them, and she was in it a lot. So I like that. And the Sackers were all interesting. I thought it was pretty obvious from the beginning, and I don't want to, you know, if we're getting into that spoiler part right now, who they actually were. So
yeah, it might come out, but okay. Yeah.
You know, so in that sense, it was a little predictable for me, because I was like, oh, I had it kind of figured out early on. Oh, that's what's happening. You know, so, and then the other thing I'll mention about the main characters is that, you know, like I said, I always love to see more of Uhura. There was one part about this. So, you know, the Sackers, if they touch you, you burn. And they put on this storyline where, you know, Uhura, when she was a child, her friend, there had been a fire and her friend had died in the fire. And because of that, she, you know, she was very afraid of fire. And shortly before the events of the story unfold, she's having nightmares and she needs to see Dr. McCoy to help her sleep because of these horrible nightmares about a fire. And I also felt that was a little predictable, because I knew where that was heading. I knew that, oh, you know what, they're going to have her face her fear of the fire, and that will be resolved in the end. So it felt a little contrived to me.
Okay. Yeah, I know what you mean, because she has this fear of fire, and she says she's been dreaming about being in a fire. And with the Sackers, you know that that their touch can burn you, and so like, oh, that's a strange coincidence. Like, oh, gee, I don't know what's going to happen with that, of course.
Right.
Yeah. But I do think that the author had a good handle on the characters that we already know, and I did read that Barbara Paul was a fan before she wrote this book, so yeah, she knew how to handle Kirk and Spock and everybody. I mean, I do like the command and the way Kirk said that the Commander Babe, like when she's giving orders, Kirk thought that it kind of sounded like him giving orders. I just thought that was a nice touch, and just to show how good that Babe was, like they thought she's a natural commander. That's cool.
Oh no, I was gonna say I agree, and I think it was obvious reading the book that the author was a fan. You know, she made a mention of Kyle, the transporter chief, early on, and I caught that. And I agree, the characters were all in character, and she had a good handle on that.
There was just one mention of something about Spock not being good at command. I kind of questioned that. I was like, I thought he was good, but that, like, the parts with Spock and McCoy, that was pretty good with their interaction and seeing, and, you know, the way McCoy was always emotional. I think that worked. But I do like, as you said, Uhura in this book, the way, well, I like that we learned something new about her, finding out her fear of fire and that she had lost a childhood friend in a fire. That was something new that they added that I like. And it was mentioned, I mean, you know, just to say this, like on Star Trek, there hasn't really been a fire that they haven't really shown fires. Like it's not as much of a problem in the 23rd and 24th centuries. But they did mention once that Geordi was caught in a fire as a child. Oh, just to throw that out there that it could still happen.
Yeah. And then remember Picard's brother and nephew die in a fire.
That's right. Yes.
And I didn't even remember that until now. Of course, this book was written before that, I believe, so.
Yes, this book, yeah, I noticed that. It came out in 1988. Yeah, that's another thing I wanted to mention, just the fact that The Next Generation was already on TV. It had, you know, just been on a season when this book came out. But there was also a mention where Uhura was thinking that she doesn't like touch pads. And I was like, I know that that's in the book because of The Next Generation, because they have touch pads there, but on the original series, they didn't. They had buttons to push. And Uhura was thinking, you know, she likes the buttons better because she actually can feel it, you know, when she pushes the button, but with touch pads, you're kind of not sure if it registered when you touched it or not, that kind of thing. I just thought that was interesting.
Yes, I did notice that, and at the time, I guess I didn't pay attention to when this book was written, and I was thinking it was written before The Next Generation had aired, and that maybe the author was talking about some of the movies, but it probably was Next Generation. That's kind of funny. I should have thought about that. Yeah, I distinctly remember her saying, "Oh yeah, these." You know, it kind of reminded me, you know, how people complain, "Oh, I don't like the when the phones went to the." Touchpad from being the actual keyboard phone. So
yes, and so I do think this book brought out some things that are still relevant today, which is what would be like any good Star Trek book. The parts about accepting people who are different, that's a big part of this book that really comes out more in the end, but it's something they're talking about all through the book, trying to get used to these people. Did you want to expand on that or any other thing in the book that's relevant today?
Yeah, well, I mean, that was obviously the main point of the book, that, you know, not to judge people based on their appearance. It was a bit exaggerated. I mean, you know, they're to the point where not only do the Sackers make people physically sick, but, you know, the whole crew is constantly talking about, oh yeah, you know, I don't want to ever see one of them, or oh yeah, you know, I what is there, something Scotty says, calls them a monster or something like that. I can't remember, but so it was a bit exaggerated. You know, to me, in a way, they were kind of behaving in a way that I wouldn't expect them to behave. You know, maybe we could acknowledge that they made people sick, and so you didn't really want to be around them. But they seem to be like making fun of them to a degree that seemed a bit immature. But I mean, I guess that was the point she was trying to make. You know, and I sort of knew where that was going at the end too, that, you know, it was going to turn out that, hey, you know, if we just take time to get to know people who are different, maybe we can, you know, realize that they're not so bad, and maybe there are some things that we can get used to, after spending some time with the Sackers, the four crew members that are on board the ship with them are kind of able to not wear the helmet. They can kind of start to get used to how bad they smell, and they're sort of able to listen to them without, you know, going deaf. So they can kind of get used to it. So.
Yes. After you spend time with them and get used to them, and then you can also get used to things like the smell, which they didn't think they could, but yeah, they got acclimated to it after a while. And also there was a line in the book where Kirk said, "All lives are of value." I mean, I just thought that's so weird, because that could be in a book today. I mean, because it's just something that you hear so much, or something very similar to that today. It's just that very idea. And the part about all lives, because it was something in the book where the Sackers had killed some people, and to them, they didn't think anything about it. They just thought they were doing what they had to do. And Kirk was saying that you have to learn to kill and to hate. You're not born with that. And I just love that idea that he threw that out in the book.
Yeah, there was a scene where, I mean, and the Sackers, you know, pretty violent. They killed some people pretty violently and had some pretty much no remorse for it. And there was a scene where they killed one of the Enterprise crew, basically burning him to death. Which was that scene. I wish they had not included that in the book, because it was really disturbing to me. And you know, when Scotty is upset about this, they're kind of like, "Well, was he related to you?" And he was like, "No." And they're like, "Well, we don't understand why you're upset." Then, you know, they didn't get it. And then, you know, the story starts with the reason that the Enterprise comes into contact with them is because this star system, the Beta Castelli system, which is the homeworld of a race of people called the Zergosians, has been completely destroyed by a new universe, a universe that's 3 minutes old, so hence the title. And the Enterprise is able to find out that this has to do with that the people who have caused this is the Sackers. So they've killed an entire star system, and as the universe continues to expand, more people are dying. And they go to a planet where the Zergosians had a colony called Holos. And the Sackers have tried to kill all the people on that planet. And again, don't really have any remorse for it. So it was interesting, because on the one hand, the author wants you to feel empathy for the Sackers, because they've been ostracized, but it's hard to like them, not because of their, you know, the fact that they smell, or they sound terrible, or they look terrible, but that they seem to be killing without remorse, and they don't really understand, you know, why people's lives are of value. So at the end of the book, you know, we actually learn that the people who had formulated this plan were the adult Sackers, who all died in an accident. And the ones that we're interacting with in the book are juveniles who really didn't know, this is what they were taught from the adults. And they have to learn from the crew of the Enterprise that, you know, what they were taught from the adults is wrong. But, you know, the book gives you the impression that because they're juveniles, you know, they still have the opportunity to learn and to not carry on that way of thinking because they're young. So it was interesting how she did it that way, because she wants you to have empathy for these people, but at the same time they're doing these horrible things. But then you realize that, well, the young people that have done some of this were indoctrinated into this belief system. So in some ways, it's not exactly their fault, because they don't know any different. So it was also kind of a book about what happens when people are indoctrinated into this kind of belief, and how much is it their fault, and how much is it the fault of the system that they were brought up in.
Yeah, that's an interesting thought, because it was kids that that Kirk and everybody had to deal with. And if it had been the adults, it might have been a lot different. I mean, they wouldn't have been able to reason with them as well. But of course, the adults wouldn't have asked for their help, because these kids asked for their help because they needed help with engineering, communications, and command and navigation. And so they needed those things. And even about having the idea that they're so repulsive, it's harder for that to come across when you're reading a book. I mean, you know, if we could see it, it would probably have more an effect. So just reading the book, and you keep reading that they're repulsive, but then you're also reading how they're humorous, and it becomes a little more easier to accept while you're reading the book. So I guess we can go on to final thoughts. As I said, I did like the book, and I think, you know, as you mentioned, it's mostly an Uhura book. I think she really shined in this book, the way it was about her and learning to cope with her fear, and the fact that she was the one who was able to translate their language. She had started working on trying to figure out the Sakura language, and actually, I don't know why, like, they couldn't have had the universal translator do that. But anyway, so what are your thoughts on the book?
Yeah, I liked it. I did think there were some things that are a little contrived in there. But overall, I could imagine this being an original series episode. It fit right in with a lot of the themes that we've seen in the original series. And it wasn't too far-fetched for a lot of original series episodes. I thought it was good. And I liked the time that we got to see with Uhura, and I liked seeing Scotty working with Mr. Green, and even Chekhov, you know, was humorous in this. It did have some very funny moments in it. And so overall, I'd say it's a good book.
And you know, having the fire at the end, one thing about that, though, is I was expecting, like, you know, when Kirk said that people from the Enterprise were going to beam over to the Sakura ship and put out the fire, when he said that they were going to beam over, I just expected the fire to be put out, you know, instantly, but it didn't, because they still had the big fire, and Uhura and Kirk were caught in it. And of course they had to be, because that was part of the story of Uhura facing a fire. But yeah, but somehow I just thought the fire should have been put out a lot sooner.
Yeah, it did seem like it took a really long time for them to put a fire out on the starship. Like, I guess they tried to explain it that like some systems weren't working. So I was kind of like, okay. But I mean, the real reason was I think a little contrived, and so that Uhura would face her fear of having to, at the end, where she's stuck in a position where she has to, you know, walk past fire.
Yes. But other than that, I do think it was a good book. And I just have to say this, too. I typed up my notes, and when I type in Sacker, and my autocorrect kept changing it to Slacker. But anyway, so it's Sacker. Anyway, but yeah, I would say I do recommend it, and I think it's pretty good for, I would say, a good young adult novel. Even though you mentioned the part with the murder, that is a little disturbing. But other than that, it seemed, you know, more of a lighthearted, entertaining book, and it was a pretty fast read, wasn't it?
Yeah, it was. It was pretty lighthearted and a fast read. Now there was some scientific stuff that I can say that I didn't really understand, and maybe the author kind of like tried to skim over that. Like, to me, it was never really clear. So the premise was that the Sakers are supposed to be buying this ship from the Zergosians. So the Zergosians are building a starship for the Sakers, but they steal it before it's complete. But this ship has the ability to open a new universe, but also to close it. But it was never really clear to me, like, why are the Zergosians building this ship with the ability to open a new universe in it? So they kind of didn't explain that. So it was a little glossed over. It was like a kind of a convenient plot device.
Like when you're watching an episode and they have all this technobabble, and Yeah, I always kind of gloss over it. Like, I know they're explaining it in their way.
Yeah, so I think if you're like hardcore looking for technical explanations, then this is not going to work for you. It's contrived, but a good book, and an interesting read, especially if you're a fan of some of those minor characters that we don't see so much.
Yes. So they did say that when the Zergosians, or when the ship created the new universe, that, you know, it creates a new universe within our own, and it's expanding, but they said that it resembles our universe at the time when our universe was 3 minutes old. I mean, that's, you know, just to explain, that's where they get the title of the book, The 3 Minute Universe. So, and that was at the time when the Enterprise first discovered the new universe, that it resembled our universe when it was 3 minutes old, and that's how they knew that it was a new universe that was going to create and expand within our universe.
It's an interesting concept.
Yes, it is. Okay, so I guess we'll end it there. So we both said we liked the book. Okay, great. Thanks, Jen. See you next time.
Yeah, bye. We'll talk to you next time.
Thanks for listening. Make sure you hit that subscribe button and join our Facebook group. Live long, and may the Force be with you. Nanu, nanu.